The Earth gets all of its energy from the sun, and then it returns all that energy in the form of heat back to space at night. And so if we lost all the energy we got from the sun during the nighttime, the temperature of the Earth, easy to calculate, would be 0 degrees Fahrenheit. But because we have greenhouse gases in our atmosphere, that slows down the release of the heat at night. And it traps it like a thermal blanket, so not all of the heat that we got during the day is released. And because we have greenhouse gases in our atmosphere, we're able to maintain sort of a balmy 60, 61 degrees Fahrenheit global average temperature. But the real kicker for all of this is that the amount of greenhouse gases in our atmosphere is only 0.05% represented by mass. Only 0.05% of greenhouse gases is the difference between 0 and 60 degrees Fahrenheit. So it shouldn't be lost to the general public that a small increase in greenhouse gases can have a huge effect on our planet's global temperature. The problem that we have wrapping our brains around global warming or climate disruption is that it doesn't have a physical face. You can see a hurricane, you can see tornadoes, you can see hail damage, you can see straight line wind damage, you can see the physical representation of the thing that's about to get you. Yet with climate change, it's invisible. It's something that's causing something else to happen. So when we have all these issues about not being able to create a monster that we can attribute climate change to and then focus in on that, on how we're going to fix it, it almost makes it unfathomable to the public. For example, we had a huge cold outbreak in November, and a lot of people say, where is your global warming now? But it turns out because the Pacific Ocean was much above normal in its temperature, it actually fed a typhoon with energy that allowed it to sustain itself and move further northward than we've ever seen before. It got all the way up into the Alaska region, and it actually caused the jet stream to buckle. It pushed against the normal weather patterns so that it made Alaska much warmer than normal. But where there's a push, there's a response. And the response was that the jet stream over the United States took a much more southern dip, and it actually brought cold Arctic air across our region. It's a global event. It's not warmer here, but it was certainly much warmer in another part of the world. And that's the problem that we have with climate change, that it's about the average conditions. Some of us will experience warmer, some will experience colder, but the overall combination of warm and cold, the Earth will be much warmer. At the very core of climate science, it's understanding that climate change is here. It's happening now. But the timing and the magnitude and where it will happen in any particular location at any one time is still a forecast problem, and still there are some unknowns. And climate deniers really focus in on this because they will capitalize on the unknowns. And they will eventually convince the general public that scientists know nothing about anything, that somehow we're out there trying to falsify scientific information. And that's simply not true. Scientists themselves tend to be very skeptical. Their job really is to understand truth. And it's very hard because there is no book of all knowledge. So scientists come up with ideas and they vet them through what we call the scientific process. It's not good enough for scientists to believe they are right. It's not good enough for scientists to know they are right. Scientists must convince each other that they are right. And we do this through a process that has no expectation about the outcome of the ideas, but rather we remain loyal to the process.